Matthew chapter 22, verses 23 through 33 is the text of Scripture we're studying together as God's church this morning. Please look in your Bibles at that passage of Scripture. We're going to read it in just a moment. Before I read it, and before we can move on any further in our study, I'm going to ask God's help on all of our lives and our hearts and our receptiveness this morning. Father, help us as your church to receive your word as it is not the words of men, but it is the word of God. May we receive it in such a way that we are open to learning new things that we had not known before. We are open to being corrected in things we had believed wrongly before. And we are open to being obedient to areas in which the Word might encourage us by the Spirit. Lord, I pray that you would help me to speak truth. I pray that you would cause what I say to not be an addition or a subtraction from your Word. Comments I might make would be complementary to the truth, supportive of it. Help us, Lord, as your church, and bless us with your word today. In Jesus' name, amen. I think you'll agree with me that loaded questions are annoying. You ever had a loaded question asked of you? You know the ones I'm talking about? Those questions where you know there is no intention of gaining an answer or to provoke a better understanding, but ones where the questioners are trying to shut down the conversation or the argument and declare victory. Supposedly by embarrassing with the foolish answer, loading questions or gotcha moments. And usually you can figure out quite quickly if someone is interested in an answer or if they are trying to embarrass and discredit you. For example, if someone were to come up to me and to say, "When did you stop beating your wife?" You can tell that's a loaded question. For if I answer, "I don't," they might say, "Oh, you don't stop?" If I answer, I don't beat her. "So you did, but you don't now?" And an entanglement of words and explanations and trying to explain all that. And he can go away at any time during the conversation, smugly confident that at least in someone's eyes, I have just admitted to spousal abuse. He got me. A gotcha moment. Tricky, unfair, frustrating. On the Tuesday before Jesus' crucifixion, he deals with these loaded questions from three groups of temple authorities. And of course, he answers them with the wisdom that the traps set by these questions actually backfire. And he's shown to be all-wise God in all that he claims. The first of these groups to ask him a loaded question were the Pharisees and the Pharisees' disciples and Herodians. They were the Jewish political supporters of Rome. And we considered their political question last week about taxation in verses 15 through 22 of this chapter. And yet, Jesus had little time to continue his teaching in the temple before another group of temple authorities, those called the Sadducees, approach him with another loaded question. And this question, like the previous one by the Herodians, is intent to discredit his authority and power as Messiah, as teacher. And so this is the Holy Spirit-inspired text we're going to read today, beginning in verse 23 of Matthew 22. "The same day, the Sadducees, who say there is no resurrection, came to him and asked him, saying, 'Teacher, Moses said that if a man dies having no children, his brother shall marry his wife and raise up offspring for his brother. Now, there were with us seven brothers. The first died after he had married and having no offspring left his wife to his brother. Likewise, the second also and the third, even to the seventh. Last of all, the woman died also. Therefore, in the resurrection, whose wife of the seven will she be? For they all had her.' Jesus answered and said to them, "You are mistaken, not knowing the scriptures nor the power of God. For in the resurrection, they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are like angels of God in heaven. But concerning the resurrection of the dead, have you not read what was spoken to you by God, saying, 'I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob'? God is not the God of the dead, but of the living." And when the multitudes heard this, they were astonished at his teaching. In verses 15 through 22, the question posed by the Herodians expected an exhortation as an answer. What do you mean by that? Is they were expected as an answer something they should do or should not do. Should we pay taxes or should we not pay taxes? The question posed here by the Sadducees does not expect an actionable answer. It's not about what they should do or not do. It's expecting an instructive answer. Furthermore, not really expecting even an instructive answer, as it is challenging Jesus to defend the doctrine of the resurrection. Now understand that the doctrine of the resurrection to the Jewish-minded person is not just the doctrine of whether the body will rise from the earth, but is in fact another way of saying the doctrine of the afterlife, the doctrine of eternity, the doctrine of eternal life. For they concluded that if there was no resurrection, then there was no life after death, and if there was no life after death, there is no eternal life. And by the conclusion of that, the supposed answer would be, then what we have to live, what we have to know, is what we can see, feel, touch now. This is it. And we need to know a little bit about these Sadducees before we really get into what the question is and what's going on in Jesus' answer. The Sadducees were the aristocrats of the Jewish population. They were the wealthy portion of Israel. They were actually the majority of the Sanhedrin Council. Now, the Sanhedrin Council, that was the religious, or you might say religio-political, right? It was both religious and political. But the religious council, the leaders, the elders of Israel, the Sanhedrin were the ones who were in charge of all Israel Jewish life. All that had to do with the temple, all that had to do with religion, all that had to do with teaching, all went through the Sanhedrin. The high priest and his family were Sadducees. Now, the Sadducees, we're not talking about an ethnic group here. This is a religious sect, a way of thinking by a certain group of them. They were the aristocrats, the wealthy, the nobles. They were politically motivated and very wealthy. And as usually happens in any culture, they were then often not trusted by the common folks as much. They were often at odds and disagreeable with the Pharisees, which we've looked at before, who the Pharisees are. The Pharisees were the common people. They were the middle class or lower class. They had the trust of the people. And thus, even though the Sadducees were richer, more politically connected, and had the majority position in the Sanhedrin, they often had to defer to the Pharisees because the Pharisees had the populace behind them in decision-making. The greatest power, though, that the Sadducees wielded was when temple or priestly things were in consideration, because they ran the temple. The Sadducees have often mistakenly been classified as irreligious, as liberals of their day. This isn't really true. In some ways, the Sadducees were far more conservative religiously than the Pharisees. Let me explain it this way. The Pharisees believed that oral and written tradition of God's laws were equally valid and authoritative. In other words, to a Pharisee, if it was spoken by a rabbi, it had the weight of God behind it, and their traditions were passed on orally, had the weight of God behind them. That's why the Pharisees looked to obey hundreds and hundreds of laws, both oral and written traditions. They believed in a very wide view of, you might call it, inspiration. A wide view of God's authority in tradition and laws. The Sadducees were far more narrow and even fundamental in their thinking regarding God's word, God's truth. They believed that only written scripture was viewed as authoritative in the lives of Israel. Furthermore, they also taught that only the first five books of the Old Testament, known as the Torah or the Pentateuch, was authoritative for Israel. So they rejected the prophets. They rejected the Psalms as authoritative. They viewed them as good writing, historical writing, but not as God's word. Thus, any doctrine that the Sadducees thought could not be found in the first five books of the law, they viewed as untrue. Now, interestingly, we have the first explicit statements of the resurrection or of the afterlife, eternal life, found really probably in Job and Ezekiel, Isaiah. And so they rejected the concept, as Matthew tells us here. They don't believe there is a resurrection. Now, so understand, the Sadducees disbelieving in the resurrection of the afterlife was not due to the fact that they just believed liberal things and they didn't believe in such things like that. They didn't believe it was found in God's authoritative word. They didn't believe it was true. The Sadducees were very much temporally minded. They believed that whatever God would do for his people to deliver them and provide for them would be in the life they live now, not in a supposed life to come. Thus, they were very religious, but their religion, but it was a religion that looked at what God would do for them now. It was a religion that looked at what blessings could be brought by God's deliverance now. And if you would not receive it now, if it was not in this life, it was a useless doctrine. Interestingly, the Sadducees also rejected the doctrine of angels and spirit beings. They often minimalized the idea of miracles. And seems to be the reason for this is they were very earthly minded. They're very minded on very rationalistic, it's for now. They believed God delivered. They believed God would save his people, but they only saw God saving his people in a very present deliverance from the oppression of Rome. They saw no concept of God eternally saving his people and no concept of an eternal life after you die. They didn't believe any of that. Their focus was this life alone. In fact, I don't think it's a direct correlation, but I find it interesting because some of the largest religious groups in our world today, or might I say some of the largest churches within what's called evangelicalism today, believe the same kind of things that the Sadducees did. Now they might pay lip service to heaven, pay lip service to the reality of the afterlife, but most who call themselves evangelical today live as if God is only the God fitting for today. What I can get today, what he will give me now, the best life that I can have while in this body. And in that way, there's a similarity, I think, to the Sadducees. They knew the Torah well, evidenced by their digging up of this strange law in verse 24. But they were religiously temporal. We were concerned about how obedience to God's law could benefit them in their relationship now, not what happens after one dies. So while they knew the Torah well, they were not students of the rest of Scripture because they just discounted it out of hand and they didn't believe it was God's word. And so this arrogance is what leads them to approach Jesus with far less flattering respect than their counterparts, the Pharisees, simply just calling him teacher. What's this question they have to come with, and this loaded question these Sadducees come with? In thinking through the structure of this biblical passage, I want you to notice this with me. You notice the Sadducees come to Jesus with what they suppose is first a strong theological point, something from Deuteronomy, a strong doctrinal point here, followed that they believe is a clear Torah teaching, followed by an illustration, rather fanciful one, which we're going to get to, and then followed by the gotcha moment, the problem, And here's the problem with it, Jesus. Here's the problem. Your resurrection and this law in the Torah are at odds with one another. Jesus, if you'll notice in the text, answers them, first of all, not with doctrine, but with their problem. Well, you're mistaken. You have a problem. He then explains the resurrection and concludes with the strong theological point, a doctrinal point at the end. He works backwards, as they do, first highlighting their problem. Look in your Bibles. Follow closely with me, though, as I first examine this gotcha trap that the Sadducees are setting for Jesus. Then we'll look at his answer and its significance. They begin with in verse 24, teacher, not quite as flattering or flowery as the Pharisees' address in the previous paragraph, but yet disingenuous just the same, because the whole point of this question is to discredit him as a teacher. Moses said, a teacher, Moses said. Now, an appeal to Moses is not in and of itself a bad thing. Jesus often appealed to the Old Testament, referring to it as Moses and reading in Moses. And it usually refers to the first five books of the law, the Torah. But it is worth noticing, if you just jump over to verse 31, how Jesus does not appeal to Moses, though what Jesus quotes is found in Exodus and what they quote is found in Deuteronomy, both penned by Moses. Jesus says, but concerning the resurrection of the dead, have you not read what was spoken to you by God? Seems like they appeal to Moses. He appeals to the source of Moses' writing, God. Now, Jesus wasn't pitting what Moses said and what God said against one another. He was simply, I think, pointing out a greater authority than even Moses. So what did Moses say? What did God's law say? What is this strange passage? It says there, teacher, Moses said that if a man dies having no children, his brother shall marry his wife and raise up offspring for his brother. Now that is a strange little phrase, right? I mean, a little sentence there. How many of you have really spent a lot of time in your devotional thought considering this passage? It's actually found in Deuteronomy 25, 5 through 10. And most of us can sit around saying, man, I'm really blessed by learning about this little law. That if in the Old Testament, if a man were to die without having children, that his younger brother was supposed to marry his wife, his now widow, and he was supposed to give her children so that she could raise up offspring. And most of you are saying, not only have I not meditated on my devotions very much, I've never heard of that before. That's the reality of it. It's just passage Deuteronomy 25, 5 through 10. It's became known as the Levirate Law. Levirate law. Now, that's from the Latin levir. I learned this week. I didn't know this before. It's from the Latin levir, which means brother-in-law. Okay? So it sounds like Levi. You might think Levite. No, it's completely different. The levirate law. And what it basically was, it did not suppose polygamy, as some might think. And it did not suppose a younger brother who was not married yet, marrying the widow of his deceased brother. And we don't find any instances of it happening in this Jewish life, except for perhaps there was a kind of a, it appears to be adjustment of it, not the exact same thing, with Ruth and Boaz. Perhaps that was a kind of a fulfillment of the levirate law, because he was a near kinsman, not a brother, but a near kinsman who married the widow of a dead kinsman to raise up offspring. And the only significance, similarity, why we think it's the same thing in Ruth and Boaz, is because there's this strange thing that took place. Remember the story of Ruth and Boaz, and after all this happened, remember he went, Boaz wanted to marry Ruth, really liked her, and so he goes, but he's not the nearest kinsman. He's not the one who's supposed to fulfill the levirate law. There's one nearer, and so he goes to that, and he has this plan to kind of say, listen, you need to marry her, but when you do, you have to raise up offspring for her and give, you know, your firstborn will be named in honor of her first husband and all of that stuff. And he says, oh, I don't want to marry her. And so remember that weird thing where he had to take off a shoe and give it to her? That's actually found in Deuteronomy 25. In this levirate law. That's really the connection of the Ruth story, is just the shoe. And what that was that they were supposed to give the shoe if the person refused to marry the widow. Give him a shoe, and they were to be known forever as the one who would not fulfill his responsibilities. That's kind of a long name, but that's what they were to be known as in Israel. Oh, that's the one who will not fulfill his responsibilities. Publicly shamed. That was the solution if one would not do it. So you have this obscure law. It's kind of difficult to fully explain. And then you have no real instances of it taking place in Israel that we know of. And the result of not obeying it was a public shaming. Not like a stoning or any kind of very serious consequences of public shaming. And I bring this all up to just point out, man, they're digging deep. They're looking as far hard as they can to find something to entangle him with his talk. And they found the lever of the law, and they think they've got it. They found a way to finally get Jesus to say something wrong. But even more appalling to me is then they concoct this outlandish story to illustrate the problem of the afterlife and the levirate law. I mean, this poor woman, did you read the story? Did you think about it that way? This poor woman, no better than property, gets married 7 times to 7 brothers, from the oldest to the youngest, and not one of them can give her a child. I don't think it's the woman's fault here. And this culminates in quite a nonchalant, and at the end, she dies too. And I think what makes it so sad is they try to pass it off as that, you know, we know a guy. Did you catch that in the text there? Now, they were with us, 7 brothers. We know a family that this happened to. I swear we know this person, you know. My uncle told me about it. They try to pass it off as true, and I don't believe this was a true story at all. It's outlandish. It's far-fetched. And besides that, Jesus doesn't even deal with the story. What I've learned of Jesus so far is he would have dealt with, this was a real issue that they were needing guidance on. What do we do about this person? This is so sad. It's family. Jesus doesn't make any comments about the poor woman or the poor family or any of this. He simply cuts right to the heart of their problem. I don't believe they're telling a true story, and I don't think Jesus believed they were telling a true story. It's a farce, an attempt like the Pharisees to entangle him in his talk, and now they've got him. Now comes the gotcha moment. Now comes the big loaded question. And it has nothing to do with marriage and family. So in the resurrection, so in the afterlife, whose wife will she be? They all had her. You see, what's the point here? What's the big concern about this question? How does the levirate law of Deuteronomy 25 somehow connect to the resurrection, the afterlife, and somehow be an entanglement in Jesus? For the Jews, as I mentioned before, the word resurrection was not just an event, but the concept of living after death, the afterlife, the everlasting continuation of the soul. Which, if you'll remember, Matthew wants us to remember this at the beginning of the account. They didn't believe in this. This life is all you got. So, it's a loaded question because they don't believe in the resurrection. That is, they don't believe in the afterlife. And they think they got him because his answer to this question, he must either deny the afterlife, or if he continues to embrace an afterlife, a resurrection of the dead, then he does deal with some sort of strange, dysfunctional spiritual polygamy or spiritual divorce in the afterlife. I mean, what are you, is this woman going to be married to all 7 men? Some kind of polyandry here in the afterlife? So your afterlife includes a woman married to 7 different men? And your resurrection, well, does it include a divorce? See what they're trying to do here? Is they're trying to talk about a love triangle. They're talking about, and in the afterlife, there's going to be a love octagon. And their goal is to get Jesus to deny one or the other in front of the people. Either deny the afterlife or deny the levirate law. If you deny the afterlife, there's a problem. If you deny the levirate law, you're denying Deuteronomy 25. They think they've got him. Either he denies the eternality of the soul or the eternality of God's law. Either way, he'll lose all credibility as a teacher, as a rabbi, if he denies either. But more importantly, they clearly knew something that everyone who had been around Jesus knew. And that is that the concept of eternal life, the resurrection of the dead, was the centerpiece of Jesus' teaching ministry. This was the centerpiece of it. Remember in John 3, when he confronts Nicodemus, he is concerned that Nicodemus be born again because, as he says in John 3, verse 16, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And you remember how it is recorded only a chapter later that Jesus tells a Samaritan woman that she should come and get eternal life from him. He used the metaphor of living water. And remember how he told the true story of the rich man and the poor man named Lazarus? And he said plainly that after they died, they woke up in another life, one being in torment, the other being in paradise. Even more plain was that only weeks before, Jesus' friend Lazarus, a different Lazarus, had died just outside Jerusalem. This was just weeks before this event. He died outside Jerusalem in Bethany. And he not only raised him, Jesus not only raised him to life, but boldly prayed to the Father, and in his prayer said, I'm only praying this so everybody can hear me. Boldly prayed to the Father. And then loudly said, I am the resurrection and the life. Ego a me. I, Jehovah, is the resurrection and the life. In fact, John 12 tells us that it was the resurrection of Lazarus in Bethany that had brought crowds to hear and see this Jesus, and it was the resurrection of Lazarus that had first instigated the leadership to kill Jesus and Lazarus. It was the resurrection, Jesus giving life, that prompted people to welcome him the Sunday before, crying out, Hosanna in the highest to the Son of David. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. The centerpiece of Jesus' teaching was not that I came to give you a good existence now, is that I come to forgive sins, to pay for sins, so that I can give my people eternal life. And everyone knew this. Jesus did not hide this. This is not a secondary aspect of Jesus' teaching. This is the centerpiece of the gospel. Life, life, eternal life is what the gospel is about. It's what Jesus was all about. Furthermore, Jesus had plainly taught on the sanctity of marriage, against divorce and immorality with clarity. So they're doing more than just trying to get Jesus to contradict the Old Testament Torah. They are trying to get Jesus to contradict himself. You have made the centerpiece of your teaching this resurrection. The centerpiece of your teaching flies in the face of logic, reason, and the Old Testament. You are not a trustworthy teacher. You are a liar. That's what they're hoping would come from this. People would see that Jesus is a liar, that he is a false prophet. He has no credibility. He contradicts himself. He teaches about the sanctity of marriage, and then he talks about everlasting life. How is these things even possible? So they mock with this fanciful and absurd story. They flatter him by calling him teacher, and they mischaracterize the biblical teaching of afterlife and resurrection in hopes to embarrass Jesus and his followers. You're crazy. You believe there's going to be spiritual polygamy or spiritual divorce in the afterlife because all the brothers had her as their wives, as wife. Have you ever been had someone mischaracterize what you believe to embarrass or to slander you? As a Christian, you ever had someone say something to the effect of, you Christians, you believe that you can live however you want. You can kill people, you can rape, you can do anything you want. And then if you just at the last minute, you just say, I'm sorry, God will let you into heaven. Remember somebody just completely mischaracterized the concept of redemption in order to make it seem so absurd that you'll retreat into the corners, you retreat into the shadows saying, oh yeah, we do believe something. Oh, I don't want to talk about this. This is what they're trying to do to Jesus. To cause him to retreat, discredit him, mischaracterizing it. So if he contradicts the Torah and suspends the Levirate law, he is no prophet from God, because a prophet would not contradict the Torah. And if he contradicts his own teaching on eternal life and denies the afterlife, he has no integrity. Gotcha. Of course, we've read the account. And their wit is unmatched by Jesus' wisdom. And just as they drive their point home by pointing out Jesus' contradictory problem with his teaching on the afterlife and marriage, Jesus starts by confronting them with their problem. And what is their problem? First of all, they are biblically ignorant. He says, you are mistaken, not knowing the scriptures. Secondly, they are profoundly arrogant. They don't know the power of God. Now think about this with me. To be ignorant is a dreadful problem. But to compound one's ignorance with rank arrogance is nothing short of deadly. Spiritually deadly, and even physically deadly. Woe to the willfully ignorant, but a greater woe to the arrogant who refuses to do anything about their ignorance. And they are both. Now, Jesus actually first corrects their arrogance, then he'll correct their ignorance. In verse 30, we see their arrogance. 29, he says, you are mistaken, not knowing the scriptures, nor the power of God. Verse 30, for in the resurrection, they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are like the angels of God in heaven. See the profound arrogance in that they are satisfied that they understand all things about the supposed afterlife. In this concept of the resurrection or living after one dies was preposterous to them, nonsense. But their arrogance had led them to unbelief in essentially God as being God. You see, if God is not powerful, if God is not all-powerful, then what is he? What is he? To believe in a God restricted by our imaginations, our abilities, our logical cogitations about what is possible and what is not, is to believe in essentially ourselves. Either God is God alone, and thus can do as he pleases, or we are gods and we must do as we please. You see, the theology of the Sadducees looked first at themselves and how God could benefit them now, and this led to a denial of the power of God to both save or judge a soul eternally. A God of the temporary alone is no God at all. Might I say it this way? A God who gives you and promises you your best life now is no God at all. Ultimately, their unbelief in the power of God caused them to assume that what they saw now was what it would be then. Let me explain it this way. They saw their reality as ultimate reality. And thus, in their arrogance and no belief in the power of God, they had no room for a greater reality. And so they assumed, as it is now, in your supposed resurrection, well, obviously it would be the same then. All that could be understood about the afterlife is understood in what you see now. This is the ultimate reality in which we live, they thought. So they naturally assumed, arrogantly, that since marriage and material inheritance and bearing children was so important now, it would be of equal importance in the resurrection, if there even is one. Because this is the ultimate reality. The relationships we have now, this is all there is. This is what it is all about. We're the center of the universe. So Jesus corrects their arrogant assumption about what eternal life will look like by teaching with the kind of authority and certainty that comes from one who's been there. And he teaches them that relationships in eternity will be different than our relationships now. He says, in the resurrection, they neither marry nor are given in marriage. Now, before I explain this a little further, I want to first say it's not a denial of relationships in heaven. Not what he's saying here. Or even of love. Or perhaps even a greater love or a greater relationship for your spouse in heaven. It's not saying that's not true. This is not teaching that we'll become gender neutral in the resurrection. It is simply Jesus saying that God gave relationships. God gave a certain reality for this world. But since this world is not the ultimate reality, but the world to come is indeed the ultimate reality, we cannot expect relationships meant for this world to be the same as the world to come. We can expect them to be better. In fact, we expect everything to be better in eternity. In fact, he says that it's going to be better. Instead of being like this, we're going to be like the angels of God in heaven. That's better. That is, in the issue of marriage, we will not need to be making covenants in marriage or be bound to a spouse. We'll be bound to God forever, having eaten at the marriage supper of the Lamb. And we'll find that our relation with him is angelic. That is, it is an everlasting one where we'll serve and enjoy him forever. You see, marriage is temporary and meant for the temporal world in which we live. Our union with God is eternal and meant for the world which is to come. Their arrogance of thinking they knew all about the afterlife, if there even was one, and that it just didn't make sense to them, led them to grossly misunderstand what eternity is all about and even to deny it. So there was a profound arrogance that they knew. We know what it's going to be like. And it just doesn't make sense to us. But we also see their biblical ignorance in that they had their belief that only the Torah was Scripture. And truly the afterlife and resurrection is found throughout the Old Testament and other places. Job 19, 25 through 27. For I know that my Redeemer lives, and he shall stand at last on the earth. And after my skin is destroyed, this I know, that in my flesh I shall see God. That's quite explicit, isn't it? When my skin is destroyed, in my skin I shall see God. Isaiah 25, verse 8, he will swallow up death forever, and the Lord God will wipe away tears from all faces. And then verse 19 of Isaiah 26, the next chapter, your dead shall live. I mean, you can't get more explicit than that. Your dead shall live. Together with my dead body, they shall arise. Awake and sing, you who dwell in dust. For your dew is like the dew of herbs, and the earth shall cast out the dead. So we see it throughout the Scripture, but even in their own books of Moses, whom they appeal to, there is the resurrection and the afterlife. Perhaps not as explicit, but clearly implicit in the simple statement then made by God. And Jesus quotes in verse 31 and 32. So in 30, where he confronts their arrogance that they knew all about the resurrection, they knew all about marriage, they knew how it was all going to work out, he says, you don't understand, you don't even know. You think you know, and you know nothing. You think it's all about this reality. There's a greater reality, far greater than the marriage relationships in heaven. And now he says, and besides that, you're also ignorant biblically. Concerning the resurrection of the dead, have you not read? Now, isn't that a bit of a slap? Have you not read? Can't you read? I mean, for you, for the Sadducees, it's only 5 books. Have you not read what was spoken to you? I love that. The pronoun use. This is Exodus chapter 3. Who did God speak this to in Exodus chapter 3? He spoke this to Moses. But Jesus, and this is, I think, a great example of exposition. Jesus takes what was spoken to Moses and he says, it was spoken to you. It was spoken to you. Have you not read what was spoken to you by God? Saying, I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. This passage, as I said, is Exodus 3. It was no slight scripture to the Jewish people, including the Sadducees. In this text, God names himself for the first time as Jehovah. The everlasting covenant he made with Israel is made and shown to be proven here. This is the famous passage where Moses, God meets Moses in fiery shrubbery. And he introduces himself as, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. Literally in the Hebrew, I exist in the present sense as God of Abraham, God of Isaac, God of Jacob. And Jesus makes a startling connection, and though he doesn't ask the Sadducees a question per se, his own interpretation of this, God is not the God of the dead, but of the living, which is Jesus in application of it. He makes this, almost this question, maybe his own loaded question to them. How can God be in the present sense, which Exodus 3, 6, and 16 grammatically and textually affirm, how can God be in the present sense the God of these three famous dead people if there's no afterlife? How can God be the God of Abraham when it's been 600 plus years since Abraham walked the earth when he told this to Moses? How can God be the God of Isaac? Present sense, present tense use there. How can he be the God of Isaac? And how can he be God of Jacob when 400 years has elapsed since you've been in Egypt? I mean, he could have said, I was the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But you see, I am not anymore, Moses, because they've been dead now for 400 plus years. But don't worry, I could not save them from death, but I'm going to save you from the Egyptians. You see, the hope of Israel was that God is able in his power to rescue his people, not only from the Egyptians, not only from sin, but even from the bands of death. And since he is presently the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, this strongly implies that not only is God still able to rescue, but they are still alive. And that's why Jesus punctuates it by saying in this little grammatical insight, the present tense, God is not the God of the dead, but the God of the living. In other words, he wasn't saying God's only the God of those who are still alive. He was saying God is the God of the living, and those who are dead in God, he is their God still because they're still alive. So those dead in righteousness are yet alive and will be alive in the resurrection. But what a fascinating thing he does here, because they go to this law, and this levirate law in Deuteronomy 25, and they go to this obscure passage, and they come up with this little twist in this loaded question. And remember, we've talked about this before, the rabbinical method of appealing to the earlier teaching. Jesus goes back to the foundational, the pivotal text where they become God's people again, where his holiness is on display, where his name is named, where the one that they quote, Moses, is being quoted to by God. And here, Jesus takes the being verb, and he uses the being verb to, I am, and ego eimi is what it is, or Jehovah. He uses the being verb to prove the afterlife. This is not the application. This is not really what we take from this text. But I cannot wait to sit around the throne of heaven and have Jesus teach. Man, it is going to be good stuff. Better than anyone here can do. And he's able to take that passage on the fly with them bringing it. He doesn't even pause for a minute. There's no, oh no, I'm embarrassed because they've mischaracterized. Now you guys haven't understood what I've said. Oh, you guys have got it all wrong. He just heads right to the problem. You're ignorant, you're arrogant, you think you know everything because this is your ultimate reality, and you miss the most foundational passage of Scripture in your own Torah. You miss the being verb. The being verb, which is the main meaning of God's name itself. The I am, you miss that one. Remember that? I am the God? Present tense? Yeah, God is not the God of the dead. He's the God of the living. By the way, it doesn't say it in Matthew, but in Luke, it says that the Pharisees responded and said, "You have said well, teacher." They were kind of happy he put the Sadducees in their place for a minute. What do all the people respond with? They're astonished. They marvel. They got no answer. They thought they had Jesus with a gotcha question, and he reveals their ignorance and arrogance. So what do we do with this text? What do we do with it? I mean, it isn't like the argument with the Pharisees where Jesus gives a command, go pay your taxes at the end. There is no plain exhortation in the text. It just ends there with this statement. I ask you to bear with me for a few more minutes today while I briefly point out three responses that I think we can have to this text. They're not profound, as in something that you've probably never heard before, but I'd urge you to consider. First one especially is simply this. Marvel at Jesus Christ's power and wisdom. If you gain no other encouragement from this unique scripture text, gain this. Jesus Christ, set before the people as Lamb of God, is facing intense scrutiny and testing before his sacrifice for our sins. And they throw strike after strike, and to use the baseball analogy, he keeps hitting it out of the park. Our Lord Jesus Christ is indeed proving himself to be not only king, not only prophet, but the perfect sacrifice who can take the contradiction, the slander, the attacks of sinners on his own self. The scrutiny of the critics come out after him, and he neither contradicts the word of God or his own self-witness as God. So just marvel for a minute about Jesus here. And thank God that he is the one who is your suitable Savior. Thank God that he is the perfect sacrifice who has proved himself to be beyond any kind of scrutiny. Just marvel at his wisdom and power. But I'd also ask you this morning to consider the error of the Sadducees. Consider that this life is not the ultimate reality. We learn that the Sadducees' great error, plagued with both ignorance and arrogance, was their settling in on their 70-plus years as the ultimate reality. But Jesus in this text challenges this assumption. You see, they looked only for a God who could give them pleasure, happiness, material, and satisfying relationships here and now. But Jesus comes with a better reality, a city not built with hands, a relationship not bound by marriage, a hope not ending in death, a joy in God not based upon political deliverance. Think particularly with me about the topic they bring up, though many could be considered. This is important. Your ultimate reality and joy will not be found in being married. Your ultimate reality and joy is not found in having children. Your ultimate reality will not be in being able to pass on a good inheritance, have a legacy or a heritage in your family. In fact, the single people who are saddened that they are not married, I encourage you that the angels are single. And one day all of us will be. Because God has called us to a greater marriage in the age to come. The eternal age, and an eternal union with Christ forever, covenanting with him forever in joy. Do not become so enamored with the earthly blessings that you have no room for the eternal ones. Our dear friends who are LDS around us are trapped by this in their religion. Now, I usually don't spend much time in sermons calling out particular doctrines in the LDS religion, but this one is so glaring in this text of scripture. I think it's fitting that the very thing that Jesus teaches against is central to the LDS belief system. No, the Bible is plain. Marriage is not eternal. Marriage is not for time and eternity. Eternal polygamy is not godly. The scripture is plain here, and it takes all manner of twisting, unfair twisting of Christ's words to get it to say something else. There is no marriage. There is no marrying. There is no giving in marriage in the resurrection. This is no small error, for it is the error of eternal marriage that destroys the eternal joy of the union we have with Christ forever. You see, by taking a good relationship with an earthly purpose and infusing it with heavenly and eternal characteristics, religion is able to turn hearts and eyes away from gazing about what is the ultimate reality, who is Jesus Christ. The ultimate joy is the warming glow of Christ. Christ alone is the ultimate reality. Not that I'll be sealed forever in a covenanted marriage union. Friends, the same problem, though, can afflict us who maybe don't believe that particular doctrine, but we've become quite satisfied living as if this is our ultimate reality. We've become quite content living as if passing on a good inheritance and a heritage to our offspring, having a good name, having our names put on buildings or bricks, that's what it's about. My friends, if that's what you're living for, if this world is your ultimate reality, there is an eternity of disappointment awaiting you. My dear brothers and sisters, you believe Christ, you rest in Him, and you long for that ultimate reality of eternity, there is an eternity of joy waiting for you. And thirdly, flows from this, so rest in the promise of eternal life. Rest in this. Rest in this, dear child of the King. God is not the God of the dead, but the God of the living. So like Job, rejoice. Because when your flesh is eaten by the worms and you've gone from ashes to ashes and dust to dust, still know this, your Redeemer lives. And He shall stand at the last on the earth. And after your skin is destroyed, and it will be, this know, that in your flesh you shall see God. Rest in the reality that death has no power over God. God has all power over it. Rest in the assurance that those in Christ who have gone before you, they are not dead. And that it is not death to die. Because if He was their God while they lived on this earth, He is their God while they live eternally. Rejoice in the power of God to conquer death and to give His people eternal life. This is why Jesus came. So rejoice and rest in the power of God. Death is but the cruel ferryman, the last gasp of sin's curse that brings us who know God in Christ into His glory, holy, and perfect presence. Rest in that reality. That is ultimate. Let's pray.